In this video, we'll go over some shortcut rules, or the rules that would enable us to compute the derivative much faster than before with the difference quotient and the limit, because this way there's only so many functions we can compute, but anything, let's say with a radical or something we cannot simplify, would definitely would help us to have some other tools or what should I say? I wouldn't necessarily call them rules, but basically any kind of patterns that would help us, or the tools that we'll develop in our toolkit. Okay, so let's take a look at some of them. The power rule is definitely the one that would help us a lot, because this helps for any kind of exponent. So let's say if we have a function as x to the power of n, we can take the derivative where the power n comes down and becomes a coefficient, and then x, and notice how the power reduces by 1, even if the power is negative, we still subtract 1. So we can practice a few of them. For example, if it's x cubed, the derivative would be 3 comes down, and we subtract 1 from 3, so we get 3x squared. If we have x, we can rewrite it as x to the 1 power, and notice what happened. 1 can come down, and then we subtract 1 from 1, so we get the power of 0. If you recall, x to the 0, anything to the 0 is 1, maybe except the 0 itself. But here we'll assume that this variable that with the power of 0 is 1. So the derivative of x is 1. Now, what about derivative of any constant? Well, if we see it above, how we counted x to the 0 is 1, well, we can add x to the 0 here to make it look like using the power rule. And notice when we take the 0 down, yeah, we can subtract the exponents, but since we're multiplying by 0, everything becomes 0. So we're going to remember from now on that the derivative of any constant is 0. And this is how we would know. So not just 3, but any constant, in fact. So again, just any observations that would help us make it quicker. And again, in number 4, sometimes it helps to rewrite the function that would make more sense. For example, if x is in denominator, we can rewrite it as x to the negative 1 power. And notice we can take the derivative the same way. The negative 1 comes down. We can subtract 1 from negative 1. In this case, it becomes more negative, which is negative 2. And a lot of times we want to put it in the same form as it was originally. So we'll keep the negative 1, but we can put x squared in the denominator and make it a positive power now. Same thing if we had 1 over x squared. You can rewrite it as x to the negative 2. And same process remains, which you'll get negative 2x to the negative 3, which becomes negative 2 over x cubed. So if you practice enough with these rules, hopefully they'll become automatic. What about some radical rules? Same idea, kind of, square root of x. Square root is actually power of 1/2. Any kind of rules with this, you can have any rule. Let's say nth root of x is the same thing as x to the 1 over n power. So the root goes in denominator and the power goes in the numerator. This is something we remember from algebra. So notice square root is the power of 1/2. Same idea remains, 1/2 comes down, but then we need to subtract fractions. 1/2 minus 1, which is 1/2 minus 2 over 2. This will give us negative 1/2. And again, we can get rid of the negative. So we have 1 in the numerator, 2 remains in denominator because of the 1/2, and x to the 1/2 comes down, and it can also become square root of x if you want to simplify it, okay? So again, the 2 is the coefficient times square root of x, okay? Then we can study some rules that would enable us to take derivative of many more functions than just the ones with a simple one term, okay? For example, sum or difference. It's fairly quick and easy because sum and difference, the way it works is we take the derivative of the first function, then we retain the same sign, plus or minus, and then we take the derivative of the second function. Okay, constant multiple rules. The way I remember it, you keep the constant. Let's say you're trying to take the derivative of 3x squared. You keep the 3, and then you take the derivative of x squared, which is 2x, and so you'll get... Notice how you get 3 times 2x, which becomes 6x. And when you practice enough, you'll start remembering to multiply the constant by the power when you take the derivative. And that's what we usually do. And a lot of times when you have a negative function, you keep the negative 1 as a constant. And that later on makes the same kind of sense. So now we can take derivative of any functions that look like this, for example, added or subtracted with the multiple terms, which is a polynomial essentially, okay? So derivative of 12x cubed minus x squared plus 7x minus 5. Let's go over this, shall we? So 12x cubed, so 12 times 3, that's how come we get 36x, and the power reduces by 1, so 36x squared, minus 8x squared, so 8 times 2 becomes 16x, plus 7x, derivative of 7x, remember how derivative of x was 1, so that's how come we just get 7, and derivative of negative 5 is 0. So that's how come we end up with a final answer. So notice I jumped straight to the final answer even though I write it out here, because it just helps to remember how to do it quickly. And we're going to be using these rules a lot in the coming chapters. Okay? Here's a couple of observations. They're not really rules, but it helps to know. Derivative of constant times x, just like we had with a 7x right here. Notice it's just a constant, which was 7. So if f of x is 90x, the derivative is 90, and so on. So it just helps to remember quickly. Derivative of a constant, as we've observed, that's just 0. Okay. And now we can compute derivatives of more functions. Let's say 3x to the 4th minus 6x cubed plus x squared over 8 plus 5. Same kind of idea. So 3 times 4, that's 12x cubed. Minus 6 times 3, 18x squared, plus, now we have 2 over 8, which will reduce to actually 1/4, so it becomes x, notice how it's just x now, over 4, and then derivative of 5 is 0, so that's gone, okay? Now here's more, what about negative powers? 10x to the negative cubed plus 5x to the negative 4 minus 8x. Well, the derivative, 10 times negative 3 is negative 30. X to the, again, we subtract, negative 3 minus 1 gives us negative 4. Then 5 times negative 4, that's how come we get negative 20. X, again, we subtract 1 from negative 4, that's how come we get negative 5. And then what's the derivative of negative 8x? That's just negative 8. And that's it. What if we had the variable and denominator. Just as before, we can rewrite the original. Again, let's not confuse the original function with the denominator. Notice how it's still f of t. You can rewrite it to get it out of the denominator as 7t to the negative 1. And whenever you have one variable and denominator, don't use quotient rule, which we'll learn later. Just rewrite it with a negative exponent. It makes it much easier to take the derivative. So we have 7t to the negative 1 power, because it was just 1t in denominator, minus 5t to the negative 3rd power. And now we can take the derivative. So remember how negative 1 times negative 7, negative 1 times 7 makes it negative 7. And we reduce power by 1, gives us negative 2. And then it became plus because it was negative 5 times negative 3. That's how come it became plus 15. T to the negative 4, and the original function didn't have negative exponents. So here we get rid of the negative exponents, so we can have negative 7 over t squared plus 15 over t to the 4th. And just with this simple manipulation, we can change the answer. Same idea, you can do it with a different radical. We had a cube root in denominator. It becomes power of 1/3. And then it also becomes negative 1/3 because it was in denominator, okay? Again, we can take the derivative the same way, negative 2 times negative 1/3, x, and then negative 1/3 minus 1, which is basically negative 1/3 minus 3 over 3. That's how come we'll get negative 4/3. And now multiplying the constants, 2 times 1/3 is basically 2/3. You can multiply just the numerators to the negative 4/3 power, which we can leave 2 on the top, and then 3 is in the bottom, and then x to the 4/3 goes in the bottom too. And you don't have to rewrite this with radicals. It's simpler to leave it this way. Okay. Now here it looks like quotient rule, x cubed plus 5 over x, but sometimes you can simplify. If it's just one term like this, you can divide. And then so you can avoid quotient rule, you can use the power rule still, and which is what we do. Notice x cubed plus x becomes x squared, and then 5 over x, you can keep like that, which becomes 5x to the negative 1 power. So now we can take the derivative. Notice f prime of x equals to 2x minus 5, because it was negative 1 times 5, x to the negative second power. So then it becomes 2x minus 5 over x squared. And that's it. So again, power rule should become your number one trick in our tools, or number one tool, I should say, not a trick, to use. Anyway, and here's some more notation. D over dx, or capital DX with a bracket, that basically means to take the derivative. Sometimes we take derivative of expressions instead of functions. So that's instead of using f of x all the time. Basically, it means differentiate or take the derivative instead of using the function notation. So notice how in the earlier sections we had this notation and take the derivative. It works the same way. Notice the first thing I did, I still kept the derivative. And I rewrote x to the 3/2 power with a negative, so you get rid of it from under the denominator. And then notice how dx disappeared. Basically, in the next step, I took the derivative. So notice I kept the 9, and then we took the derivative of x to the negative 1/2 power, which is negative 1/2 x to the negative 3/2 power. Then plus 2, again, multiplied by negative 3/2, x to the, this time, negative 3 over 2 minus 2 over 2 will give us negative 5 over 2. And again, we can rewrite it without negative exponents. So 9 times 1/2 is basically negative 9 over 2. And notice how 2 stays in denominator. X to the 3/2 goes in the denominator. Minus, well, it became minus because 2 times negative 3/2, the 2's will cancel, but you still have 3 on the top. And then you have x to the 5 over 2 in the denominator. So again, sometimes we need to simplify the original function. Sometimes we simplify the derivative function just to get it in the form that it was originally, okay? But that can happen. And there's some other variations of the same problems. Whenever you hear the word slope of tangent line, then that means the derivative at a particular point, like x equals 2. If you find the equation of tangent line, it works the same way as if you were writing equation of the line, okay? So if you're trying to find slope of tangent line, first we take the derivative of the function, which is right here. Then we'll plug in the 2, and that's how come we get negative 28. So we would know at that point that x equals to the function is decreasing this steeply, actually, negative 28, okay? And then to find the equation, well, we have x of the point, we have the slope, but we don't have the full point, which is why we must find the y of the point. So we must plug in 2 into the original equation right here, into the y, to find the y, and then we can write the equation of the line. So notice this is why I plugged in into the original function, and I get negative 22. Okay, so if we proceed, then we find the equation with slope negative 28 and the point 2, negative 22. And I use the point slope equation y minus the y of the point, which became plus 22, equals to the slope times x minus the x of the point, which is 2. Then I distribute the negative 28, and then I subtracted the 22 from both sides, and that's how I got the answer, okay? Here were a few problems in section 4.1 where we can find values where the tangent line is horizontal. Basically, we take the derivative, okay, which becomes 6x squared plus 18x minus 60. Now you set it equal to 0 because a slope of horizontal line is 0. Now, if you can factor it, do so. If you cannot, you may have to use quadratic formula and simplify the square roots. That happens here where we're able to factor out 6. Practice factoring skills, because in chapter 5 coming up, we'll definitely need them again. This one we were able to factor, luckily. And so we get 2 points, negative 5 and 2, and that's actually the answer. And then we can do different applications, for example, with the revenue. Notice how this was an application I did earlier. And I believe the problem is asking for the marginal revenue, which is... I'm sorry, sometimes my dog decides to join me when I'm making videos. So let me backtrack a little bit and try to work on this last problem. So this is a revenue problem that's given by the demand equation, which is quantity equals to 5,000 minus 100p in terms of the price. We want to find marginal revenue for the following production levels, values of Q. And here's the hint that's given. Solve the demand equation for the price and use the revenue equation, which is price times quantity. And the reason why we want to solve it for Q, because only the quantity is given. Notice in A, B, and C. And so to solve for P, notice basically I try to isolate P. You subtract 5,000 from both sides. Q minus 5,000 equals to negative 100P. Then what I did is I divided by negative 100, which is how come I got negative 1 over 100Q plus negative 50,000 divided by negative 100. Basically get rid of a couple of zeros, so we'll get positive 50. And that's the price equation. Then we plug in into the revenue, make it quadratic. Notice how multiplied by p distributed, so we'll get negative 1 over 100p squared plus 50p. And then to find marginal revenue, we apply the derivative. So we get negative 2 over 100p plus 50, which becomes negative 1 over 50 reduced, p plus 50. And now we can plug in various levels, like 1,000, I get 30, at 2,500, I get 0, and at 3,000, I get negative 10. So notice marginal revenue was increasing. So revenue was increasing when it's 1,000, but then it actually reached a maximum. That's what it looks like at 2,500, which is why it's 0. In chapter 5, we'll start studying when the derivative is 0, we'll either have maximum or minimum, depending on possibly. You know, there's other situations that can occur. And at 3,000, it looks like it starts decreasing. So it looks like it was a maximum there. And that's it for this section.